Hey guys, my name is Cicabeot1. Putting this list together has made me realize that 1982 is way more stacked than I ever realized when I was actually going through the year end. So, screw it, no intro again. Top 15 time, let's go. In my world, Out of Touch Thursday is every Thursday. There was a time I thought I disliked Holland Oates. I don't know why, maybe something about their style of old pop rock came off as lame to me. But they had three hits on this year end, so I had the opportunity to reevaluate them and, yeah, I don't mind them so much anymore. Even the song of theirs I expected to hate, I Can't Go For That, parentheses no can do, I thought had a nice dreamlike quality and an interesting structure with the timing of the backing vocals. Did it in a minute is nice and jaunty and a good time, but Private Eyes is the upbeat, feel-good jam that I found myself revisiting the most, because it slaps. There is a video out there that sets Out of Touch by Holland Oates to a clip from Lucky Star of these girls dancing, and I feel like you could use this song for a similar effect. Whereas some of this duo's other songs came off as kinda corny, like Rich Girl or Maneater, Private Eyes is just a legitimately good time. You get the typical Hall & Oates piano sound, but also strong guitars with their colorful 80s flash that make this enjoyable despite my own personal biases. It's the kind of cheesy that I guess is more socially acceptable, at least to my brain. Also, the hook is really strong. Lines delivered with confidence, insanely catchy, well-placed hand claps, always a plus for me, almost makes you forget that Hall is pretty much stalking this girl. My eyes see everything you do. Isn't that romantic? This is gonna be a theme of this list going forward. Songs whose lyrics can come off as creepy nowadays. And in this case, you have what seems like a stalking song. Well, Genius does explain that he's doing this because he suspects his partner of cheating, which, that's also kind of a weird fit for happy pop rock, but I'll take it, I guess. It also explains why everyone's wearing detective outfits in some shots in the video. Oh, yeah, this music video was also kinda lame. Just the band with some backing musicians playing the song in a dark room, and I think whoever played the drums in the video was hitting the snare on the wrong beats at the beginning. Ironically, the next number one on Billboard was Physical, and, well, you can't say that video is boring, but I'll still take this one over Physical. This is 80s cheese in the best ways, and it made me realize that maybe I was wrong about this band all these years. These guys were alright. I don't know if I could consider myself a fan of this band just yet, but they are growing on me. As for a band that I've always been a big fan of, though, yep, there was a time where I considered The Police one of my favorite bands. Do I still think that? Probably not, but they were damn good. You ever heard of the movie Nanny McPhee? It was a 2000s British family movie about an ugly nanny tasked with disciplining a large family of misbehaving children using magic. Odd part of my childhood, but I remember really liking it. And it had this song in one of the TV commercials. So whenever I hear or remember this song, I remember this movie. Thanks for that, Sting. Not that I ever needed that movie to appreciate this song because, well, it's pretty beautiful. The Police were a band that most frequently wrote songs about misery. Message in a Bottle was about isolation, Can't Stand Losing You is straight up about suicide, So Lonely, take a guess, you couldn't possibly get it wrong. It wasn't the only thing they wrote about, but even as a kid, it was a pattern I noticed. But Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic gives Sting a little hope after years of turmoil. It feels like pure infatuation, a reason for him to keep going. And the only thing stopping him here is his own insecurities. But other than that, it's nice to hear this guy in a more positive state of mind, and the instrumentation is fittingly magical. It feels different from some of the punkish older Police tracks, and instead feels very pretty and kinda pop. And I think it paid off. Apparently they tried to add more guitar to this to make it sound more like a Police song at the time, but nothing really stuck. And honestly, I can't imagine this song any other way. You don't want to take away its whimsy. At least Stuart Copeland gets some pretty wicked drumming in with the outro. Some other people my age may fondly remember Copeland's music from the Spyro games, but I didn't play any of those games until 2019. But even still, I don't think I appreciated just how talented of a drummer he is until I heard some of those Spyro songs. And yeah, I hear that talent here too. He really snaps in this outro, making this an unforgettable passage and the best part of the song. A magical end to a magical song, and a strong entry from a childhood favorite band of mine. Yeah, a lot of this list is gonna be full of songs I heard often in my childhood. This next song, however, is entirely new to me. Yep, Stevie Wonder's getting a shot at redemption on this list. Paul McCartney, not so much. His other hit this year, Take It Away, is alright, but it's only alright. Do I Do, on the other hand, is so vibrant and intense that it doesn't quite forgive a song like Ebony and Ivory, but at least you can say you've also got this. I hadn't heard this cut before, or Stevie's other solo hit from this year, That Girl, but it didn't take long for this to win me over. A lot of my favorite hits from this year were simple, catchy pop or rock songs, and this almost feels like higher art when stacked up against songs we've already talked about, and the ones yet to come. 5 minutes long, which is doubled in the compilation album it's on, complex rhythms, multiple bass solos, Stevie's impressive belting, this thing has it all. Is that overselling this? Probably, it's just a funk track. Get over yourself. In a way, this song does feel a little overwhelming compared to a lot of other hits at the time. I don't know why, considering it's not that far removed from Superstition, I Wish, or Higher Ground. However, unlike those songs, this is a sex jam, I think. Yes, I got some candy kisses for you, Nip. Yes, I got some honey, some chocolate jam. And I don't know if I know any other Stevie Wonder sex jams. He's gotta have them, right? This is a man I believe has sex, and yes, it's all in the voice. That high, forceful voice that makes it even harder to believe this was the same guy in Ebony and Ivory, which I'm going to stop mentioning for the rest of this segment because by now, I think you get the picture. Maybe that's why this feels a little overwhelming. He's a force of nature here, absolutely excited when he sees this woman. This girl is so beautiful, she can make the blind see, apparently.
That wasn't meant to disparage the blind. I just think it's kind of ironic that he said that, alright?
I don't know if this is gonna be a song that sticks with me as much as others from Wonder's catalog, or even one I'm gonna seek out much, but if I do seek it out, I know I'm gonna be in for a good time. Also, let me reiterate, awesome funk bass solos. I will never not appreciate funk-based solos.
I'd love to get more familiar with Stevie Wonder's old songs at some point, but for now, we gotta move on to more familiar territory. Like an old, meaningless phone number. Pop music has some really weird priorities sometimes. Hey! A song about wanting to call a number written in graffiti. How heartwarming.
I got a couple questions asking if the worst list thumbnail was a reference to this song. Maybe because of the whole number on the wall thing? I don't know. I actually really like this song. My nostalgia for it is too strong, even though actually taking into consideration what the song's about makes me go, what? This is what the song is saying. I know nothing about this girl other than she left her phone number on a wall, and that alone is enough to excite me. I guess growing up you don't understand how weird songs are in concept. Like, the kids who grew up with Justin Bieber's Sorry are gonna realize one day when they're 22, wait a minute, Bieber's an asshole on this song.
Doesn't mean that kind of thing is a deal breaker for me, especially in this case. Oh, you don't know me.
To
Tommy Two-Tone, or Tommy Heath as he's actually known, Two-Tone is the name of the band, it's weird, goes about this in about as uncreepy a way as possible. He's not portraying a guy looking to score, mostly just a guy looking for happiness. I mean, the writing still says, for a good time call. But the way Tommy sings about it, he almost seems naive to the sexual implications. And with that mindset, I think it's adorable. After all, the song takes place entirely before the guys even made the call. Maybe he just wanted someone to play Atari games with, I don't know. Okay, nah, that line right there shows he's not so innocent in what he wants. But for most of it, you can still pretend he doesn't know what for a good time call really means.
Besides, it's fun to pretend that this guy doesn't know what sex is.
But probably most importantly, this song is just super catchy. It's lightweight pop rock with a simple four-chord structure, but it uses that structure well. And it somehow makes a random, meaningless phone number into an infectious pop hook. I can probably recite this number faster than my actual cell number. Also, I feel sorry for anyone who actually had that number back in 1982, and even still to this day, a lot of creeps are still probably calling you. This is infectious, goofy, and a joy to listen to every time. Now, if only it was still the highest charting hit song with a phone number in the title.
It didn't hold the record for the highest charting song about a weird from afar crush, though, even at the time. Because that undeniably coveted record belonged to this.
So I have no explanation for what I thought was going on in Jenny when I was growing up, but I do have some sort of explanation for Centerfold. So you know that whistling sax melody that opens this song? Well, I think that melody, as well as the emphasis on organ in the verses, led me to believe this was a song about baseball. In fact, I still kinda hear it, at least as a song that could be played on the speakers at a ball game. Along with the song being called Centerfold, oh, you mean like center field in a ballpark? Sure, that makes sense. If you're a child who's not supposed to know about porn magazines yet.
One of the 100 biggest songs of all time on Billboard, everybody.
Like with Jenny, I can see people turning on this one nowadays for its subject matter, because who wants to sing along with a guy perving on a former classmate's pinup shot? And yeah, while it is about that, it's also about the loss of innocence, both for this girl and for the narrator, and at first he's actually pretty overwhelmed by the discovery, feeling he shouldn't give in, going through the memories he has of wishing he had this girl's attention, until finally deciding to just go for it. So it's more of an inner monologue than it is a song about just ogling a picture.
And that makes it okay, right?
Okay, I know it's weird, and it's a situation that would very much weird me out if it happened to me, but it's not really hurting anyone, and once again, to turn that sort of sexual frustration into a radio anthem that's so infectious it makes you want to sing along is impressive. Though, of course, making a quarter of the song a chanting of na-nas certainly helps with that. I've seen songs get slagged off for nonsense lyrics and video reviews, but considering this song already said what it wanted and needed to in three verses, and it has no guitar solo, I think it can get away with this. It's catchy as hell, and of course, the guitars, synths, and even whistling blend together well for a satisfying climax. Really, those elements are good throughout, but they're especially great here. It's this outro that makes this a feel-good summer romp and a cornerstone of 80s pop rock.
But what if this song is somehow a little too straight-laced and normal for you, and you want something much cheesier? Well, I think I got just the thing.
This is gonna be a little more of an indulgent pick than some of the previous ones. Or maybe this fits in well with some of my other picks. What can I say, I like dad rock. Whatever that term means. Hell, I'm pretty sure my dad doesn't even like this song or band. There's There's no deeper meaning to this or any concepts that makes you do a double take when you get old enough to comprehend it. In fact, the most interesting thing about the lyrics is how all the lines start with everyone in the verses, everybody in the chorus, and you in the post-chorus. Simple stuff that somehow I didn't notice until I looked these lyrics up online. So it's technically nothing special. Just, hey, we're singing about this hot girl, I think, and people are excited for it to be the weekend soon. But it doesn't matter, cause it kicks ass. It's bright with those synths and chugging guitar riffs and Mike Reno being a serviceable presence behind the mic for a jamming synth rock song. This is exactly what I want my weekends to sound like.
Oh boy, I can't wait to spend this weekend playing video games and pissing away half the day by sleeping in. It's gonna be great. Come on.
I especially really like that post-chorus riff, how it chugs for a bit before going down for that ascending pattern, and then those triplets come in and truly make this the perfect driving song. Like, to the grocery store and other errands, I say, for the weekend. But then there's also that fuzzed out solo, I think. Can this really be considered a solo? Either way, it's exciting and sounds awesome. And I guess that's all you really need. Again, simple in concept, simple riffs, but it sets its mood well, and I always welcome it when it plays through my speakers in my car. I do know a couple other songs from this band, namely Loving Every Minute of It and Turn Me Loose. Those go for more grandeur and are probably more interesting overall, but Working for the Weekend still works for what it is. A fun pop rock song and a defining 80s classic.
This is the kind of song I'd play in my car on a first date. What would I play if I felt it was time to take our relationship to the next level? I think I got a pretty good candidate for that. Little ditty about Jack and
Diane. Two American kids. Before you ask, no, this song isn't on the list because my name's in the title. Because it's not. I spell my name with two N's. Also because, well, I grew up with this song long before I started going by that name anyway, but I didn't always love it. This is one of those tracks I just sort of accepted as a fact of life. Like, yep, it's pretty good, but is it truly exceptional?
It's like eating fast food. You probably don't have any strong feelings about it, but it's there. Unless you don't eat fast food, in which case, good for you.
That isn't to say there's nothing distinct about this. That post-chorus riff is all sorts of distinct. The electric bits that get followed up by the softer twang that emphasizes the booming percussion, and then the acoustic strumming that accompanies most of the sung bits. That's something you don't forget. And thinking about it now, I find it kinda unorthodox. It must be hard to make this kind of structure work and not feel disjointed. I guess that's a testament to John Mellencamp's charm as a musician. No wonder Keith Urban wrote that song about him.
And if only Keith Urban was anywhere near as good.
But this is all stuff I took for granted as a kid. I remember the moment this became a great song for me. I think I was late into high school, not quite in college yet. I was driving, and this song was on the radio. I heard that bridge, and I realized, oh my god, this song is amazing. Why didn't I notice those lyrics before? I don't know, too young. But, well, I had recently been 16 at that moment, so it struck a chord with me. And then from there, I really started to realize that this was basically a teenage love story. Detailed vignettes between two characters with the main conceit that, well, life doesn't get any better than this.
That's a depressing thing to say to high schoolers. Long after the thrill
of living is gone. But I get it. People do get nostalgic for the days they didn't have that many responsibilities. See also Back in the Day by Ahmed from 1994. It's easier to appreciate being a kid when you're not a kid sometimes, or when hearing about a story of a couple kids, since this is more of a coming-of-age story happening in the present. Suckin' on chili dough, outside taste freeze. But I'm rapidly approaching my 30s, so the most use I have for this is a nostalgia trip. Hearing John say, "Life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone," that's not a thing to fear anymore. It's just sort of reality. Okay, not exactly, but it does still hit hard. Diane says, "Baby, you ain't missing nothing." Do I wish to relive my high school experience? Probably not, but in some ways, I can acknowledge I did have some good in my life, and living vicariously through this song now and until the end of time is probably how I'm going to do that from now on. I may not have had a Jack, or another Diane for that matter, but I can still look back fondly.
And before we look back even more fondly at some other old hits, let's take a break and roll through our first batch of honorable mentions.
The Go-Go's were one of the most successful acts on this year end, with three songs in total. All of them catchy as hell, all total classics to this day, and We Got the Beat in particular is simple pop rock, but easy to get stuck in the head. Great stuff. However, Our Lips Are Sealed does edge it out. Just as catchy as We Got the Beat, but that sweet-sounding bridge clinches it. Simply magical. This I feel I need to shout out simply for existing. You may know that I was a band nerd in school, played the flute, so seeing classical music on the charts at all at any point in time is mind-blowing to me. This is a medley of tunes from Mozart, Beethoven, and others that works as a faithful homage, but also makes it feel a little more modern for the time thanks to the reworked drums. Even despite that, this absolutely did not belong on the pop charts, even back then. So the fact this was an honest-to-God hit at the time, I have to commend that. Just as classic as Centerfold, but those camera shutters aren't quite a substitute for those big sing-along moments and distinct organ sounds. New Wave staple with its signature echoey guitar riffs, but these guys didn't deserve to be a one-hit wonder because of Space Age Love Song. Thankfully, that song somehow found its way in Spider-Man Homecoming, and I want to kiss the person who decided to include that song in that movie. I'm just now learning about this song, and am now hearing it kind of frequently on the radio, even in a subway once. I wish I had heard about this sooner, because hot damn is it a triumphant as hell pop song. Also, Laura Branigan's voice is fantastic. I kind of associate this song with being stalked, mostly because of a Simpsons scene where Marge is stalked by a character voiced by Steve Buscemi. Really, I think this song might be kind of creepy without that saxophone. In fact, it's kind of creepy with it, but like, in a good way. Definitely prefer this to something like Somebody's Watching Me by Rockwell. I don't remember there being that much disco on this year end. Makes sense, it's not the 70s anymore. I'm glad some still made it though. This in particular slaps. The way Donna just belts this chorus often gets stuck in my head. Rest in peace, ma'am.
I don't know anything else about Donna Summer, but to think that we lost both her and Whitney Houston in the same year, that just doesn't feel right. But let's not dwell on that for now and get back to the list proper.
So far, I've talked about mostly pop rock songs that just scream 80s within the first few seconds, but I haven't really brought up any full-on new wave songs yet, have I? Or at least songs I'd consider more new wave than rock.
So let's get started on bringing some of those in, shall we? Starting with that one song that Rihanna sampled for one of her earliest hits. You know the one. Sometimes I feel I've
got to. This is another song I feel like I can take for granted, something I don't give a serious thought to unless I hear it in the car. A staple of new wave that's probably one of the first examples to come to mind for the genre, along with possibly I Ran and Take On Me. I can imagine that at the time this sounded like the future of music. Heavy synths, invoking some imagery of space. I mean, there are sound effects in the song that sound like spaceships to me, and then there's the weird music video I just discovered where star people dance in a guy's bedroom. Geez, songs like these I hear almost exclusively on the radio my entire life. It almost feels like I've been missing out when I finally see the music videos the artists shot for these songs. Did you know I hadn't seen the Once in a Lifetime video until this year? Why is David Byrne acting like he's giving birth? Once I ran to you, now I'll run But yeah, this is about as catchy as they come. It sounds equal parts comforting and kinda intimidating. You have the lyrics about this love taking its toll, I mean, about love that's too overwhelming, and how he feels like he's got to escape, with the forceful instruments and at times spooky sound effects. But at the same time, the synth tones and atmosphere are on point.
I've been playing a lot of Silent Hill lately, so I'm tempted to bring up some sort of comparison with those games, but admittedly, this probably wouldn't score an encounter with Pyramid Head all that well. Oh, tainted love.
Yeah, that's just not spooky enough. But that's okay, because that's not really what it was going for. What it was going for was a modernized approach to an old, forgotten Motown song. Yep, Soft Cell's biggest hit is a cover of a Gloria Jones song from 1964. And unlike with What's Forever For, this wasn't an artist covering another band's deep cut from just a couple years prior. This was a band adapting a soul single from nearly two decades prior that didn't do well in the charts when it was new. And yet Soft Cell's version was still a top 10 hit. And I will say, I do like the original too. Being a 60s soul song, it's much faster than the cover we know today, with plenty of energy and attitude that was commonplace at the time. Soft Cell did substitute some of that attitude for mystique in their version, and either way is a good fit.
I'd be surprised if anyone watching this has never heard the Soft Cell cover of this song before, but I do want to encourage you to give the Gloria Jones original some love. I think she's earned it.
On the radio where I'm from, the Soft Cell cover is often played as a medley with a cover of the Supremes' Where Did Our Love Go? The full medley is more than 8 minutes long, which at that point the novelty kinda wears off, especially since Tainted Love on its own is only about 3 minutes. But the shortened radio version I'm familiar with does give a nice little coda to the fear of love shown in the first song. In re-listening to this song for this video, it did feel weird to have the Where Did Our Love Go portion missing, although that first portion is much stronger anyway, so I eventually got over it. Still, this is an important part of how I've consumed this song all my life, so I had to bring it up at least.
Speaking of old new wave songs I've probably heard a million times throughout my life,
a lot of the new wave music of old feels designed with one thing in mind: to be as maddeningly catchy as possible and nothing else. But Don't You Want Me almost felt like much more. It felt like it wanted to tell a story, one that will be remembered throughout the ages. The story of a relationship that started in a cocktail bar splitting apart.
Aw, they seem so perfect for each other.
Even though this is pretty simple at its core, it still does enough to leave me in awe, mainly because it's a duet. I can't think of many other big new wave hits that were duets, but considering how many of those songs were love songs at their core, the potential for duets certainly was there, because duets like this provide the opportunity to provide both sides of a relationship instead of just one, especially when they're clearly in different places. Here the man, Philip Oakey, portrays a man who found this girl and turned her into a star, and is now upset that his girl is now leaving him behind. The girl, Susan Ann Sully, admits in her verse that she still has feelings for him, but wants to move on to bigger and better things. Its dynamic is nowhere near as vitriolic or complex as, say, Somebody That I Used to Know, but there's still contrasting perspectives that work well together. Plus, I like how both verses start with the mention of the cocktail bar. It's satisfyingly symmetrical.
It's like the two are reminiscing together, but separately. I mean, one's telling the other to get lost, and the other kinda comes off as abusive, but it's still oddly beautiful.
And of course, the song just sounds fantastic. A memorable, cheesy synth pattern dominates the post-chorus, it's constantly high energy, and the chorus absolutely kills. Desperation has never sounded so pleasant. Also, I'm pretty sure the first place I heard this was a Chips Ahoy commercial. Don't you want me? Oh. Ah, Chips Ahoy. Remember when their commercials were good? This absolutely deserved to become a defining song for a genre and era. It nails the tropes of new wave well, while still paving its own path to feel one of a kind even today. And even though the Human League's success in America was short-lived, they left one hell of an impression with this song alone.
I'd like to continue this streak of new wave songs, but unfortunately I'm fresh out for now. So let's move back to the rock side of things and tribute an artist who unfortunately left us a couple years ago.
In a way, it doesn't feel right to me that Eddie Money is gone. Sure, he was up there in age, but he's someone that's still present on the radio stations I frequently listen to. Plus, he had a surprising amount of hits that I'm familiar with. I don't know if I could say he was one of my favorite musicians, but I do think he had a legacy that commands respect, thanks to his unique husky voice and knack for sticky hooks. Take Me Home Tonight and Two Tickets to Paradise in particular are hard rock classics that I cannot deny.
Excellent guitar riff.
And in going through 1982, I've found that I think I'm in love just as much.
I guess it's easy to take certain songs for granted when you hear them almost exclusively on the radio. Though I guess that's kind of a theme for this entire list. It controls me.
I feel like there's not a lot I can say about the way this sounds. It's just a hard rock song that's right up my alley. I love the guitar tones, crunchy and flashy like Eddie often had them. I guess it's sort of midway between his 70s hard rock roots and the flashy style of the 80s that was creeping in. The riffs are very catchy, and you get two different styles of guitar solo in one, which is nice.
But as far as I'm concerned, this song is defined by one small moment on the chorus.
The way Eddie sings that line is just about perfect. It's as if he's saying that he didn't know why he felt so different lately, and then comes to a sudden realization. Wait a minute, I'm in love! It's cute imagining this is coming out of nowhere for him. It reminds me of my trans awakening in a way, minding my own business and just everything making sense all at once and getting overwhelmed. And while realizing you're in love is a much smaller moment, it does make this oddly relatable to me. And Eddie's enthusiasm for that realization is incredibly infectious. He says his life's looking up, and it makes this feel like a personal rebirth, operating on a high that everything's going to be alright. And that's something I could definitely use these past couple of years.
I've got plenty of songs about being angry or sad in my life, so it's nice when I can get some really good songs about being happy.
This is a pretty straightforward love song, but it's the subtle things that make it amazing to me and a personal favorite from the artist who made it. And with how often I've heard it throughout my life, I wish I had come to really appreciate it sooner. Rest in peace, Eddie Money. You were pretty good. Thanks for all the memories.
But now we move from a hopeful, loud song about love to a quiet, desperate song about trying to keep the flames going. And from two artists that I'm admittedly not very familiar with.
Compliment what she does.
Now this is the kind of song I'm surprised was really popular in its day, but for all the right reasons. It's hard to comprehend that something this subdued and quiet was a top 20 hit in the early 80s. In a turning point where flashiness and image were becoming important aspects of the music scene, this light, soulful, jazzy little tune almost seems like the opposite of everything the 80s would go on to represent, and that made it stick out all the more.
Wikipedia lists this as a quiet storm song, and I think that title is pretty accurate. It's quiet, but it has the intensity of a storm.
The quiet, piano-driven part of the song is the work of producer Quincy Jones, and the intense, passionate vocals are courtesy of singer James Ingram. And let me clarify something, I am familiar with Quincy Jones' work in a way, despite what I just said in the transition. I recognize him for his work on some of Michael Jackson's most successful albums, particularly Thriller, which was also released in 1982, but its singles didn't make a huge splash on the charts until the following year, so this is what we have in the meantime. and Quincy kills the atmosphere and sound. It's so peaceful and enveloping. Gives me warm, fuzzy feelings inside, especially at that bloopy organ solo. It makes me not want to feel angry anymore. Life's too short to get mad at people online or at music or whatever has been a burden on my mind lately. It makes me want to be a good person, full stop.
And considering James Ingram's giving instructions on just that, I'd say he and Quincy Jones are on the same page here.
Ask her to stay, find 100 ways.
James's vocals are fantastic here, putting as much soul as he can into his delivery while he encourages the subject to make his lover feel special when he has the chance. Be good to her, be romantic, be honest with her that you need her. That's how you keep a relationship going strong.
If it's violin she loves, let them play.
And maybe that's a broad stroke, one-size-fits-all way to look at relationships, but it's a good start. The spirit's in the right place, and it carries a subtext of desperation for the subject he's singing to. Fear of being left for someone else, fear that you're not doing enough. Well, all is not lost. Show her why she should stay. And though, again, it is a bit broad, I think it's beautiful all the same. It's beautiful sounding, beautiful in its intentions, just a track I can't help but smile and get washed away with every time I listen to it. I can tell James Ingram was a very talented vocalist, so it's a shame he left this world just 2 years ago now, but I don't think I'll ever forget his contributions to this. It really is something special.
In fact, I think this song should be used in soundtracks or montages for emotional parts of movies, if it isn't already. I think it could be pretty effective. Hell, it worked out for this song. I haven't seen any of the Rocky movies. Take that for what you will.
At some point, this song was in contention for the number one spot. Not because it was a song I've held dearly all my life or had a strong attachment to, but because of its influence on pop culture and its effectiveness at pumping up an audience. You've seen some kind of montage in film or TV that uses this song, either played straight or as a parody. And as played out as the joke is, it's done with good reason. It just kicks ass. Okay, yeah, in some ways it is a bit cheesy. Survivor's lead singer at the time, Dave Bickler, mostly sticks to a light falsetto, only really ramping up in intensity in a few spots. But those few spots are perfectly timed at climactic moments in the instrumentation to make them stand out. It's more empowering than if you were getting a performance from a singer with a low voice who occasionally growled.
That kind of empowerment does have its place, but primarily in metal. Not so much in 80s pseudo-glam.
The riff is just too good. It's mostly repetitive strumming, but the strong power chords still sound amazing and create an unforgettable melody. This is what it sounds like to be a fighter, to overcome adversity, to fight for your life. And the lyrics, while broad, only add to that feeling. They feel motivating, they feel dangerous. And because of that, I get exactly why Katy Perry wanted to invoke the spirit of this song for Roar. And while I don't think it's that bad a song in hindsight, its weaker melodies and more meandering pace doomed it to live in the dark, dark shadow of the song it took inspiration from. Again, there is a reason this song's legacy is more than just the Rocky movie it was made for. It did its job of being an empowering fight song so well, everyone wanted to use it for similar effect. It's a cliche, but not without good reason. And even though their glory days are long over, I'm sure the members of Survivor are eating well thanks to the royalties. At least I hope they're getting royalties.
Yeah, steady guitar strumming can make for some really effective music sometimes. And hey, it's not the only song on this year-end that we get to talk about either.
Just like the water.
So I said before that my choice to talk about 1982 in particular was a bit random. Well, this song in particular was what solidified my decision to tackle this one. The song that sat at the very bottom of the year end. Not that I think it needed the placement to be remembered for years to come, but can you think of how different life would be if something else took its place? For example, I wouldn't be able to have it on this list otherwise. I of course have an affinity for Fleetwood Mac, as all good, law-abiding fans of music do. I was excited when Dreams recharted last year due to its prominence on TikTok. The Chain is an all-time great song in my mind, and I absolutely loved its usage in Guardians of the Galaxy 2. But even solo, the members seemed to do good work. Lindsey Buckingham had the song Trouble from this year, and it was pretty good too. But Edge of 17 is a thing of beauty. Instrumentally, a very simple song with its defining aspect being the repetitive strumming guitar rhythm that uses a total of three notes. It's just a good thing that the guitar rhythm is catchy as hell and that the bass rhythm and even occasional piano licks are enough to support it and keep it interesting over a 5.5 minute song.
Stevie's guitarist has gotta feel some kind of fatigue whenever they have to play this song live. Honestly, I do not envy them.
But the simplicity is also made up for in this song's five verses, each of them using different vocal melodies with some excellent harmonies. They're all so distinct and memorable, and they're performed with so much intensity that it's stuck with me for so long. In fact, 10 years ago, back when I was a Guitar Hero and Rock Band channel, I made a video where I 100%ed all the harmonies of this song on Rock Band 3. Looking back, it's kind of a bad video, and I wasn't even trying to sing well in it, but I made that video because of my love for this song. Plus, I wanted to symbolically make it before my 17th birthday at the time.
Funny, because it turns out this wasn't a coming-of-age song at all. It's about death.
Stevie says she wrote this about the deaths of John Lennon and her uncle, also named John, but spelled differently, both of which happened in close proximity a couple years prior. Not a connection I had ever really considered before. In fact, I never put much thought into what this song meant to Stevie, but with the darkness it conveys, I'm not really surprised. It always had this mysterious, cryptic vibe to it that worked because the progression was interesting enough on its own, and it of course sounded fantastic. And when Miley Cyrus took inspiration from this song for Midnight Sky last year, well, that made me very happy, because that was a great song in its own right, and kept Edge of 17's legacy alive to show that a song's lasting impact is more than just chart positions. It's always deserved so much more. It's hard for me to say that this is my favorite song of the Fleetwood Mac musical universe when the Chain exists, but it's still definitely in contention. It's such a deeply fascinating song that's been special for me for so long.
It's such a liberating, exciting song that feels like an adventure. I honestly can't imagine my life without it. And I can say the same for this next song, too, even though I heard it for the first time just 1 year ago.
I am surprised that there is a Rod Stewart song out there that connects with me as much as this. Not just because of his involvement with the Bryan Adams dud All For Love, but because in general, he seems like the kind of artist that wouldn't get respect from my generation. He's got an awkward croak of a voice, he has inclinations towards soft rock. One of his biggest songs is called Da Ya Think I'm Sexy, not Do You, Da Ya. Yeah, you go right, said Fred. But Young Turks really landed for me in a way I wasn't expecting. Although I will say, I really wish this was called Young Hearts instead, because calling it Turks gives it some unfortunate political connections that I don't think it ever intended to have.
At least I can pretend this song is really called Young Hearts, since that's what he actually says on the song.
And the way this guy sings that phrase, I don't know why, but it sounds fantastic to me. Like, it wouldn't sound correct if his voice was clean. It needed to sound this grimy to soar as much as it does, because the song's already pretty jaggy with the old-time rock and roll guitars married to touches of synth pop. I guess you could consider this synth pop or new wave, but if it is, it's definitely an outlier of those genres, and definitely an outlier for the Rod Stewart songs I'm familiar with. It's exciting, it's liberating, and it's fun. The antithesis of everything I thought I knew about Rod Stewart, which granted was not much, but I thought I knew enough for this to be genuinely surprising. Colorful synths, the rocking guitars, that soaring chorus. This song is the best kind of call to action, and probably the best justification for Rod Stewart's voice I think I've ever heard. One where the performance isn't about how good he sounds, but about how much fun he's having. The vignettes he belts out about teenagers running from the law or whatever he's talking about, this is what his career was all building up to.
No wonder this was on Grand Theft Auto San Andreas' soundtrack. I don't have San Andreas, I'm sorry.
All the elements just come together so well in the verses and chorus, and then you get the brief guitar solo and the song somehow gets even better. The echo effects on the guitar while it jams out one of the previous melodies, that's just angelic. I don't know why, but this moment just makes me feel content whenever I get to it. Just a calming, transcendent moment to bridge the last verses and choruses and make this truly something special to me. The song up until this moment and after is energetic and rowdy, but this brief moment of calmness feels incredible. Probably the best 20 seconds in music from this year. This would have been an easy song for me to dread based on the name and the artist who made it, but it managed to really impress me. It's a motivational tour de force from a guy who had no business making a song like this, and yet, he managed to make it incredible despite that.
This could have been an easy number one for me for this year, but somehow, something else came along that rocked me to my core even harder. But before we get to that, let's give some quick shoutouts to the rest of our honorable mentions.
This was the only song on this year-end not available on Spotify. And that's a shame, because it's a nice, melancholic love song that would work great for driving at night. But I guess it wasn't meant to be. Look it up on YouTube, it's a great hidden gem from this year. Fantastic vocal harmonies, booming percussion, a wicked guitar solo. Yeah, this song's pretty great. Also, my dad's got one of Asia's album covers hung up at home, so that's gonna count for something. And this also has really nice vocal harmonies, especially at this desperate sounding bridge. Gets me every time. Yeah, these are the kinds of post-breakup songs that get me the most. Pure desperation and also sexy as hell. Michael McDonald sounds like a wreck in the best ways, and it makes for a surprisingly potent song about memory loss. Highly recommended. Bit of a straggler of the 70s, being a funk and disco song and all, but when you're this punchy, it's hard to complain. This song comes off as a little bit pathetic to me at times, but it's charming for it. It feels like a guy trying to work up the courage to ask a girl out, and the melodies are very sweet and warm sounding. I can't hate this one, it's too cute. So I know pretty much nothing about Diana Ross, but this is pretty awesome, despite and maybe even because of the Snow White mirror mirror thing in the lyrics. You're probably not gonna believe me, but I grew up with both Rosanna and Holds the Line by Toto, but not Africa. Didn't hear that for the first time until like 5 years ago. Saying that out loud, even I don't believe it. But as such, I do have more nostalgia for this and Holds the Line. Besides, Rosanna rocks way harder.
And on that contentious opinion, I think it's time we finish off this list proper. Number one is next. Let's go.
So So trying to put this video together has made me realize something. Trying to say something about decades-old music is hard. Even if it's stuff I've heard my whole life, I've realized that doesn't always mean much because I've never really had to think about why I like a song like Centerfold or Tainted Love. I just kinda do. So in a way, I'm a little more interested in the stuff I've never heard of. Figure out what sticks out, how it connects to me, why I'm finding myself attracted to this song or artist I've never heard of before. And with 1982, the song that resonated with me the most came from an unexpected place. I had never heard of the song or the artist who performed it before this year, and maybe some of you haven't either.
But that's the fun of revisiting music this old. Sometimes you find things that you didn't know you were looking for. And even beyond that, sometimes you find things that just really speak to you in ways that you never expected they could.
Any Day Now is a song originally performed by Chuck Jackson in 1962, so we are dealing with yet another cover from this year. In fact, Ronnie Milsap wasn't the first one to even cover this song, but hearing his version was the first time I ever heard any version of this song, and ever since, I've been absolutely floored. Any day now. It's a song in which the narrator expects that eventually their lover is going to walk out on them. Not really a breakup song, not a love song, but something in between. And the lyrics themselves show the narrator in self-doubt and sadness, not sure that they're good enough for who they're with, dreading the day that the relationship ends, but feeling like a burden to them. And I was surprised with just how emotional these words felt to me. It's not a situation I've ever been in myself, but I could just feel the heartbreak and the dejection the narrator feels. It may be all in their head, but it feels very real to them, and to me as well.
This feels more like a song about mental health than about the actual events of a relationship. And that's pretty forward thinking for 1962.
The original Chuck Jackson version is R&B, but this cover by Ronnie Milsap takes a more country direction. You'd think the original would grab me more because of this, but it was ultimately Millsap's rendition that impressed me. And maybe you're hearing this and feel utterly confused why this is here, especially with the number of ballads that appeared on my worst list. But this cuts way deeper for me than What's Forever For or Open Arms. Until you're gone for Millsap portrays the lyrics with a subtle kind of sadness that makes this about as tragic as it can feel. It feels like he's trying to bury those emotions with a veneer of soul, but his true feelings keep revealing themselves beneath the cracks. There's an attempt to keep up a smile, to not sound so bothered, only to end up feeling absolutely defeated. I'll be all alone. And it helps that he's accompanied by some beautiful, melancholic pianos and soft female backing vocals. It just twists the knife even further and makes this sad, somber song about as effective as it can be.
But I can't deny that my decision to put this at number one had to do with some unfortunate circumstances.
In February of this year, a friend of mine passed away after a 2.5-year-long battle with leukemia. It's a loss that I'm still grieving to this day, unfortunately setting the tone for a lot of my year. The day I heard the news, the first songs I went to were Live Like You Were Dying and Welcome to the Black Parade. They just felt appropriate to the situation. And then a couple weeks later, I would start to listen to the music of 1982 to prepare for this video. This song didn't stand out to me too much until I realized halfway through that in a way, it reminded me of him. Even though the subject matter was completely different, it still reminded me of the anticipation that he was going to leave us someday, that he felt like he could fight no more and that he wanted to spend the time he had left with his family. Begging you to stay. Of course, I respect his decision, but it didn't make those last few weeks any easier. And Ronnie Milsap singing about the anticipation of losing someone close to him, though in a different way, resonated with me to an uncomfortable degree. Maybe if I didn't have that experience, I would find Any Day Now to be an unremarkable song, but because I did have that experience, to me, it's one of the most beautiful songs I know. It was the right song for me at the right time, even if it was tenuous. But I guess that's all my brain needed to fall in love with this. I know it's a weird choice for number one, and it wasn't at all the kind of song I expected to put here, but this really does mean a lot to me. Thank you, Ronnie Millsap, for this beautiful, beautiful rendition of a classic.
I'm Cicabeot1. Please donate to cancer research if you can, and take care.